Thank you for that. So, now having said that, you know, the question happens, and since many of you would be studying HR or working in HR, how many of you are related to human resources here? Okay, quite a few. And the rest I would assume is, okay, related to business. Now, I have a belief, which is that, look, the business of people is everybody's. It's not just HR, right? So, because all of us as line managers, especially if you're managing teams or managing people, have to think about how do we motivate, energize, get our teams engaged, and make work awesome so that people are inspired to perform. And Kevin spoke a lot about that, right? And one of the things for us is to think about how do we actually make that happen as an operating manager. So, the question I'm putting, I'm making a comment here, and I'm going to turn to Amrin then to give her thoughts, is my belief is that if you want to make financial capital really productive, because look, from a shareholder's perspective, what do we want? We want return on capital. We want return on equity. We want return on investment. And how do you get that? And if you want superior return of capital, if you want superior return of investment, can you actually do that without making human capital productive? Can you do that? Right? Because otherwise it's financial synthetics, right? Which could be, you know, derivative trading or stock market trading, which has nothing to do with people. But even then, there are people involved. And some people take better informed guesses, if I were to say. Because I don't think anybody has a clue as to what the stock market is going to go tomorrow. But having said that, the question is, how do we make human capital productive? And part of that whole thing is about making work awesome and inspiring people to strive for excellence, right? So, I mean, from your experience as a practitioner, as an HR manager, as an HR leader for so many years, right? What do you feel makes human capital productive? Or you might also want to comment on, what do you think from your learnings makes human capital unproductive?
Okay, so let me just kind of get certain things right. So I am in HR and formally right now, but it is not that I have been in HR for 26 years. I moved into HR, which was fairly recently, which is maybe about 3 years, okay? So I have ran a business there in the same company, and now I look after the global HR. So I've seen both sides of it. And I think the reason probably that I moved from the business, running the business, to HR, and I think that is what is imperative that I see it and what connects people, is that each one, and I think you mentioned it, that each one of us, I mean, when you're leading a business, you have to be the HR manager. I don't think the HR can be delegated to HR department. So if you really want to make people productive, I think there is no other way but by being engaged. But by being engaged does not mean that you would just, you know, compromise business or compromise profits or you know, just kind of lay out everything. I think the business sense, and I think a lot of youngsters, if I see in my own organization and in my experience of, you know, maybe 19 years in just this organization and otherwise, that if you do take people along or if you make them party to your decision making, then people do understand where you're coming from. if you do believe that you have to make your environment productive, there is no other way but kind of engaging with people. So if you do not engage, you don't get there. And I think Kevin did mention a lot about it. I did miss the initial part of it when he was talking about it. But by and large, I think the question that you are also asking is the same, that if you really wish to make people productive, is there any other way? But there are times when I do believe that you need to take a tough call as well. And that is a time when you probably need to get far more engaging with your people, with the teams around. And if you can't get there, then you have a problem. So I think it's a coexist.
Put a counter question on this. Yeah. I mean, what do you do with, you have a team of say 10 people. You know, some people, I mean, you've clarified, as Kevin mentioned, vision, mission, you've involved them, you've given the purpose. Yeah, but there is this guy who just doesn't want to work.
Right.
Right, and it's not just, I mean, it's not delivering. What do you do?
So I think...
You blame yourself or you blame the guy?
You don't blame anybody, actually. And eventually, you need to take the person along. And if nothing works out, then you know, it's the person.
How long do you keep trying?
I think it's from person to person. I don't think that there is a formula. And that is what is so beautiful about people, right? that you can't really define that whether a person would show the turnaround in 3 months' time or in a year's time or maybe never, right? So each, and it is also, I think at that point in time where the organization is, whether it has the ability to sustain and kind of give more time to the person, it also would depend on whether what is a dependency on that person. In IT I have seen enough number of times where you may feel that the person is not delivering as much, but yet the criticality of that role or the position could be such that you may not be able to take a very drastic kind of a situation. But in all situations, whether it is determining what is the period that you would give to the guy or the girl, or what action or, you know, support mechanism that you would provide, I think what really is the key here is the leader, is the immediate leader. It is the only that immediate leader who really has a sense whether that is working out or not. And the maturity of the leaders in the organization really makes a world of a difference, when I would say it. So, if a person is not working, I am sure each one who is sitting here.
There is pressure of performance on me.
Right.
I have to meet my sales targets. Right?
Right.
I am not meeting my targets, and you are saying, you know, I want to sack this guy. And he is not, I mean, whose problem is it?
Tough question.
Yeah, that's okay. What I, so that's
but
the question.
I think for the businesses, eventually, if there is no business, then there's no employment, then there's no employee, right? That is really the end of the day. That is the fact of life. So for the organizations to sustain, you need to make them profitable, right? And if people do not perform for whatever reason, I think it's fair, and most of the organizations, I would say that at least that I have observed, they give enough and more chances. But it is not just giving a chance. I think it is not that you expect the person to, you know, miraculously change tracks and start performing. I think it is what is the environment that you create around. Is it some kind of a, you know, whether the people around him or her are giving enough training, support. I have seen people, I mean, I am sure a lot of you all who have dealt with people would realize that sometimes you brand a person as non-productive. You change the environment and the person miraculously in a way performs. It's just the situation was not working out. So I think experience teaches you that you don't take abrupt calls very suddenly. You don't take abrupt calls because it does take the morale down of the company. Of the people around. Nobody likes to see people getting sacked for no reason. So I think an environment and organization which creates supporting mechanisms really well, and it is not keeping the decisions. If I have to make a decision where I have to sack a person, I would not just go and sack a person. I would give enough and more opportunities, and I would engage more, not only with that person, but with the team members around, because that person is incidental. But for me, it is important that the 10 other people who are 9 other people in the team, they should not get demotivated. How do you keep that momentum up? So I think those are the things that we need to take care of.
So I mean, what I'm hearing you saying really is, I mean, one, there is no formula. There are different people have different needs, strengths, capabilities. So we need to think about managing people differently. And I think it's important to carry everybody along, because otherwise it can have a, I mean, you can't be impulsive in taking decisions about people. I think that's what I hear you saying. So before I turn to you, Professor Verma, I'm going to make a couple of comments, and I'm going to ask you, Kevin, on your reaction to the question about how do you deal with people who are not shaping up. My belief is that you can't really have performance without capability, right? I mean, I can't expect, if you don't have the potential or the capability to perform at a certain level, however much I do appreciation, love, clarity of vision, mission, everything else you talked about, you know? We have the right planet. But look, boss, at the end of the day, everybody can't play test cricket, right? Right, everybody can't really climb Mount Everest. So all of us are limited by our potential. Or do we believe that if people have infinite potential, then everybody can do everything? I'm sure, maybe, I mean, all of you are welcome to believe that. But the question is, Kevin, and I'm going to come back to you, because I want you to talk about the experience about students. What do you do with students who are not meeting the grade? Right? So, Kevin, what are your thoughts on this? So you have an opportunity as an organization to have a guiding philosophy around this concept. The first philosophy is we are going to do our very best to hire to values and to hire to culture. So our vetting process is going to try to determine skill set. So once they get inside, I'm not questioning whether the skill set exists. I'm pretty certain that it does. There's a track record for that. And I have a sense of that, right? But I'm also going to try to onboard to engagement, because I'll discover in that onboarding and engagement path whether or not they're going to choose to connect with what we're doing or not. So I challenge organizations to be the best in the world at onboarding and engaging early employees into the system. Then, inside of that, you've got to then be very good at development, right? We've got to communicate with people. We've got to determine, can we bring these skills out that they have, that we believe they have? We've hired them to that. Now, if there's a miss and they get through the hiring process and they are not a good match, I like what Tony Hsieh does at Zappos. He writes them a check for $2,000 within the first 2 months to say, we would love to correct this miss on both of our behalves and help you on your way. So the development part of the company is, if they're going to stay for a while, we're going to focus on that. But there's a third element that I ask companies to be. And I'd like the company to be the best in the world at transition. So it doesn't matter to me whether that person is choosing to leave because they're dynamic and they're not going to be the CEO here next, or because we've discovered that they're raining on the rest of their team. And they are just a dark cloud. And what we have done has been responsible. We have had that conversation to say, we have a little bit of a problem here. There's a sense that not a team player, not bought into the culture, not passionate about what you're doing, whatever that conversation needs to be. Jack Welch was famous for cleaning the bottom 10% at GE, right? Actually, what he did first was let them know they were there. So we owe that obligation. You're in the bottom 10%. Are you interested in doing something about it? If you are, we'll give you every resource possible for the next 90 days to try to make that adjustment. But if you do not, we are going to give you every resource we have to help you transition to another environment that's going to be good for you. We don't accept all of the people that choose not to engage. That's not our obligation. And I think it connects to our first answer and our first question about what people is it, because it goes to that. I don't have to retain everyone, because this is a business, and that's more like a team than a family. We talk about it being a second family, but the reality is we're far more like a team, aren't we? People want to be on the starting lineup, they want to participate, but we have to get value. And I think that we have to take a look at that and say, all right, this is really messing up my culture. Let us help you find one that where it won't do that, right? And I think that it connects to this other question about which group of people does what, if you don't mind me just tackling that for a second. What I wanted to suggest in addition to my colleague's answer, which was great, was that I think business can be defined in about a dozen different ways. You could say it's about happiness. That means we want the customer to be happy with the experience they have with us. We want the employee to be happy delivering that experience. We want the managers to be happy with their relationships and the executive as well. Or we could talk about it as return on investment. I want the customer to be happy with their time, the time and money that they spent, and get a return on that investment. I want the same thing with my employee, my manager, my executive team. But the return on investment is not always capital. It's just a return on their investment. What do they want out of it, right? And they get that return. So I think that we get caught up sometimes in looking for words to define, and that causes us, in fact, to wander off to what's really central is, why is that guy doing that? Why is she behaving in a way that's causing disruption? My first job is to see if I can find that out and motivate them to do something else. My second job is to eliminate them as a problem for the other people. So I think that we've got to be really good at both, but we can really be excellent at it.
Mm-hmm. Professor Verma, obviously there is a entrance examination through which you hire students, right? And do you fail people?
I do. Well, before I actually get into that, I would like to speak about, you know, what Kevin and both you mentioned right at the beginning. You know, we talk a lot about the people-centric organizations and such. And I was just going to one study which was conducted by Aon Hewitt, and it said other than the leadership, which is indeed a big issue, you know, the next big issue for most of the corporate is the employee engagement as such. And then, you know, I started looking into a little more detail data, and I'm sure a lot of you would have probably heard about Gallup study and 12 miracle, you know, the 12 questions which usually they ask. And they've been conducting this study for a long, long time. In fact, each year they cover about 200,000 employees from all different kind of organizations all over the world. And surprisingly, and this is a contradiction, as a teacher, as an academician, you know, I don't want to talk about the best practices like a consultant does, but I like to talk about the next big idea. Now, the next big idea will never come unless you talk about contradiction. Now, look at the contradiction. The Gallup has been conducting this survey for several years, or probably several decades, and last year, the survey said that just about 30% of the employees they surveyed are actively engaged. And the another horrifying fact was that almost about 26% of the employees are actively disengaged. So you can jolly well imagine the kind of disruption they are probably causing to the organizations as such. So the big challenge for institutions, whether it's a corporate or an educational institution, is to really find out, because we've been doing a lot of studies, we've been trying to find out, if you look into the Deloitte universities, and he spoke about certain factors, and there are a lot of things being talked about, like these are the things which we need to do, and which will lead to probably improvement in the employee engagement. But the fact of the matter is, the past several years, the level of employee engagement has been going down, down and down. It's a big concern, even in the education institution, because don't forget the fact that getting good faculty is a big challenge for any education institution. And for them, the salary is not a hygiene factor at all. You know, for them, there are many other things which actually satisfies them are substantial. So to make sure that these guys are engaged with your institution and they do their job well, there are many other areas which we really need to look at. And I suppose some of them are very, very common, whether they are education institutions or corporate, like things like autonomy or things like trust. These are the things which I really find pretty common, you know, both in education institutions and corporate. Yeah. So that's what I felt.
Go back to the question I wanted your view on. What do you do with a student,
yeah,
who is just not putting in the effort to?
Well, we try out various things to do, you know, especially in institutions like ours and all, we raise a system of what we call as the mentoring as such. You know, so we, right in the beginning, before we hired students, before we take students as such, we enroll them with us, we do a kind of psychometric testing. It's a pretty exhaustive psychometric, and we try to find out what are those areas in which these students are really, really weak. And accordingly, you know, we try to filter them and then put them into a mentor, a faculty mentor who can probably take them through all the years. Our idea is not to chuck them out. Our idea is not to depress them or not to do that. But we are definitely, because each one of them come with a big hope to us, and we try working together closely with each and every student to make sure that for the next 2 years, when they're there with us, you know, they change. Some of them just fail to do so, and they get filtered out automatically. So okay, there's nothing which you can do about that.
So, you know, I work for a sales organization, right? I'm a life insurance company, right? And the pressure, a lot of pressure on sales targets, right? And very often I do get an email from somebody who's a frontline salesperson about, very difficult bosses, right? Bordering on abuse at times, right? And I've often wondered why, you know, we don't encourage people to disrespect others, right? And it's part of life, right? It seems to be, and yes, there is pressure of performance, there's pressure of targets, of course, there's no going away from that. But there is no reason for anybody to be rude. And the challenge is, and a lot of these young managers are also very young themselves, I mean, they could be having 2, 3, 4 years of experience and they've got elevated to a managerial position, and they see their fellow colleagues as instruments of task achievement, rather than people to be nurtured, developed, you know, helped. So one of the things in the Indian context, and I'm raising it for you to think about, is for a long time we're going to be a country which is going to be the young led by the young, right? We're a young country, right? When I started work 20 years back, my boss was 20 years senior to me. And there is a different level of engagement when you have a boss who is very secure, who doesn't see yourself as a threat, right? And is able to mentor you, coach you, guide you, appreciate you, all the things that Kevin talked about and some of us are talking about, which makes work awesome for you, which also inspires excellence for you. Now, given this reality that we're going to face in our country for the next foreseeable 30 years, 40 years, when a lot of young people are going to lead a lot of young people, and I've often wondered, in the army, the captain is leading a Jawan who's probably just 1 year or 2 years older to him. How do you explain? I don't have an armed forces perspective, but they always lead from the front. How is it that in the corporate organizations we find managers putting coercive pressure in getting performance rather than leading from the front? What's your experience and what do you think on what do we need to counter it? And what, and I'd like you to comment on, because many of them are going to be operating managers. What is your suggestion or insight or input to them?
Okay. I'll relate it to an experience that I had at a time when, you know, this sort of a situation was not there, young leading the young. So what happened was that I had a boss and he was very, demanding is, I think, very natural and nothing wrong in it. But he was something like, he was always finding fault and he would always tell, you know, you're not doing this. He would not tell what I was doing right, but he'd always tell what I was doing wrong. And the pressure was becoming too much. And at the time, I felt that I think I should quit. Okay, that's the, you know, easiest way out. Then I thought over it. And I said, let me do it this way. Okay, he's talking 10 things out of it. Maybe 4 or 5 are bull. I mean, I don't agree with it. But there are 5 things that he's talking which make sense, which are related to performance. So let me ignore the 4 things that is, you know, becoming personal, becoming too harsh on me and all that. Let me try to do my best to achieve those 5 things that he's talking about, which is related to performance and where I think I am lacking. And I said, let me perform in a way that I don't give him a reason to fire me. So I went out of my way. I took the insults or the reprimand and all that. And I said, let me walk the extra mile. If he asks for X, let me do X plus something. And I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, it's happened to me, this boss of mine who was like a tyrant for me became one of my best friends, and we parted company in the sense that he left L&T about 20 years back, but even today he calls me up, you know, once in 3-4 months and talks to me, how are you and all that, and I have very fond memories of my time with him. You know, those bad patches are not there. So I think it is up to us to walk that extra mile to, you know, okay, there are, you know, nobody is perfect in this world, you know, there are good, bad, everything. Let us focus on the good things and let me look inward, what I can do to improve this relationship, what I can do to improve this situation, this performance, and I think it helps.
So, say something. I'll just add to that, but I'll just take a draw and then come back to you. So what I'm hearing you say is, I mean, at the end of the day, he stretched you, you expanded, you remember him because your performance improved.
Yeah.
And therefore, he contributed to. Maybe the means were not necessarily pleasant initially. It was probably not so positive. And probably there is a more positive way of doing it rather than a negative way of doing it. And you were resilient enough to handle it. But at the end of the day, if you want to expand human potential, and if you can comment on that, and I want to put this question to you. If you want to expand human potential, you have to stretch. It's like a rubber band, right? So obviously, you can't stretch so much that it tears and breaks. But if we want, if nobody is making demands of us and is not, and demanding means you have to be ruthless. Can you think of a soccer coach? I mean, all of you watch soccer here? No? Think about Alex Ferguson. Or Guardiola. They're demanding. Look at Mourinho. Really demanding coaches. They make you exercise like hell. Right? Now, when do we come to a corporate organization? Where does it become fun, fuzzy? But in sports, it's as competitive and brutal as that, right? You got it. You've got to stretch the best out of everybody. Where do you draw the line and what's your experience?
You need to stretch out, you need to demand. But I think, that this is my experience, that everybody is not the same. That's why you don't have everybody entering into sports arena. I don't think everybody qualifies for everything. I think this is also true for corporates. And as I said earlier, there are times when you see people really struggling in a particular environment. The best you can do is actually, you would do certain bit of coaching, mentoring, and see whether they succeed. If they don't, I think the best thing you can do is be very upfront with them and say, this is not the place that you need to be, because you're only going to harm yourself, hurt yourself in the bargain, and then you help them. Sometimes even asking the person to leave is actually help to them, because you're otherwise completely brutalizing their ego, their self-respect, and their future prospects. So you have to be very careful because you're dealing with human beings. But I definitely believe that everybody cannot be Sachin Tendulkar, everybody cannot be, a basketball player or a soccer player. I remember I pushed my son into karate when he was 4 years old, and you know, one fine day he came and he said, Mom, you go and get beaten up like that, and I don't want to do that. So it's like, everybody cannot take everything, and that is the That is why there are so many opportunities in this world. I think what is important for you to identify, whether it is same things when I was listening to you, is about students. Some people will just not be able to make it because they have chosen the right stream, probably out of peer pressure from the parents, peer pressure, or whatever else that they believe. So it is important, I think, when you're taking people on, if you can be selective, if you can really, I mean, it's again an art. It cannot be, you will go wrong some, you know, at some places, at some point in time. But if you can hire for attitude, if the attitude is right, then maybe you can possibly get people to do certain things. But then beyond it, I think you need to, I mean, if the job is not cut out for you, it is not cut out for you. You have to let the person go.
Talking about stretch, you know, how much one can stretch and all.
Yeah.
Last night I was listening to, watching BBC, and Bill Gates was being interviewed. And he said, in the early days when he started Microsoft, every day, the first thing which he used to do, whenever every day he went to the office early in the morning, he would go to the area where all his supervisors would park his cars. So he said, like, I remembered every car, every supervisor's license number. So that, I mean, he could make out like what which guy came in, and he said every night in the evening also, every night when he went back, he will also see, you know, like which all cars are parked there. He believed in putting in a lot of work and effort and all. He said, there was nothing known as vacation for me. Vacation was an irrelevant topic for me those days. But the same Bill Gates says today, is I look at organizations, I look at people, I look at work-life balance in an absolutely different manner. I don't think we can survive. I don't think I can retain people with this kind of attitude anymore at all. So that's the kind of thing which even, you know, he spoke about.
Last night only he spoke about that.
Is changing his whole
lifestyle. I wanted to bring a couple of thoughts here. There was a concept which resonated with me long when I read about it. It's a concept called flow by a Hungarian psychologist called Csikszentmihalyi. He talks about challenge and capability. So when challenge, if you have a job which has a particular complexity or challenge and your capability is matched, right, you are in flow. So if the challenge is more than capability, what will happen? If the challenge in the job is far more than capability, you get stressed, right? You get burnt out, right? But if your capability is more than challenge, more than your challenge, what will happen? You get bored. So ideally speaking, we grow. And our capabilities probably expand with practice over time, with learning, judgment, maturity, and everything else, right? And that's how the growth path is. And not everybody will grow, as Amreen said, to become a Sachin Tendulkar. In a corporate context, not everybody is going to be a CEO. But then you have this challenge of I encounter and I've seen people who have ambition, which is running ahead of ability. Right? How do you deal with people whose ambition run out of ahead of their ability? Kevin, and then, sir, I wanted your comments on this. And how do you deal with people like that?
Yeah, I think that, again, that's a coaching opportunity, isn't it? That's an opportunity to actually have a conversation with people. I'm not sure that that's not the answer to every question that's been asked so far, is that you have to have a conversation with people. And one of the responsibilities as a leader, especially as the immediate supervisor, is to know your people so well that you understand why they're in these situations that they're in, and to try to figure out exactly what the cause of that is. Because the angry person that's raining on everyone else's parade, there's a reason for that. And it might be that we could help solve that reason and they would change, right? We can find that out. We may not be able to solve the problem, but we might be able to. But I think the key is to always have these conversations and to be as honest and forthright as you can. This is the position that you're in this environment. Are you happy with that position? And do you want to change that position? Or ultimately, do you want somebody to change it for you? Which can happen. But if you do not enlist them to become proactive on their own, it won't matter what kind of program we have in place. And it's interesting, as I listened to your answer to that last question, not everyone achieves what he's achieved in life, correct? So it answers the question for me why he was able to overcome his supervisor. Not in a negative way, but because he was so proactive, he decided to accept the behavior and be dynamic himself and won the day. because he put himself in a position where that particular leader could see him different. But that's one in 10,000, one in 100,000 that might be that proactive to do that. The masses would have shrunk from that, right? And I think the danger that we have with mixing stretching with really unacceptable management styles is we don't call it out for what it is. And what I have discovered in my experience everywhere is that it has a lot to do with insecurity in their position. They don't, in fact, know how to lead. They don't know how to manage. Probably have never been trained to do it, just was appointed like most of us. And sometimes they're lacking the skill set. So to make up for that, they become dictatorial, strong-handed, and demanding. And I don't know that I've ever seen that evolve into success over the long term. I think Steve Jobs reaped the repercussions of being what he is. I think Bezos and others are doing that now. But Microsoft's leader, Gates, changed. Branson never was that, really, and it's something else that achieves the same levels of success, right? So I don't know that we forgive the behavior. Everyone wants to stretch a bit. But I think that can be done in a much more inspiring way than to be.
I have a hypothesis here. I mean, so one is, of course, I mean, there are people who are more achievement-oriented and perhaps, you know, they're willing to, they see the larger purpose and for themselves, and they're willing to take a lot of you know, the challenges on the way. But we have this mythical belief about leadership, that leaders are like God. They do everything right. And we expect our bosses to also do everything right. And part of the thing he said is, look, I said my boss is probably doing 5 things wrong and 5 things right. Let me focus on what he's doing right and what he's doing right. Because at the end of the day, you're not going to find a boss or a manager who's going to be perfect, right? In every dimension. Or perfect for you, as the case may be. Because he might be perfect for somebody else, may not be perfect for you. So the question that I'm going to link up the point you made about conversations. And I have this standing joke with my team that I have, you know, which is supposed to be the most honest relationship you're supposed to have, right, in your life? Probably with your spouse. How difficult is it to be truly honest? It is. It is difficult, right? So it's not an easy thing to do, to have these honest conversations, and that to be the colleague, right? And how more difficult it is to have a conversation where it's about, look, you peaked, and I really don't see you getting any further. It's a very difficult conversation. So we have to see that in context. So, sir, what is your experience here as a practitioner in dealing with people of this kind, relating back to the conversations part, relating to the fact, do we have God amongst leaders? And what is your thought? And I'd like you to comment also in terms of how you've dealt with some of the challenges you face in academia or in leading teams.
Okay, talking about the first part in terms of conversation, I think one of the mistakes that we make in our life, I'm talking about the corporate part, it applies at home also, is that we normally get into a conversation when there's a crisis or when there's something great happening. What we need to do is we need to have a conversation at all times. Because when you have a conversation at all times, you are able to show your genuineness in terms of concern for the person. It could be your wife, it could be your colleague, it could be a boss also. So when you have this sort of a relationship where the genuinity is there as the underlying base, the foundation, then what you communicate is taken in the right spirit. What you communicate is not seen in terms of words, but in terms of the intent, because not everybody is good in words, you know. But then you realize that it's coming from the heart, and therefore you accept it. The first answer is that the conversation has to be regular. The other thing, you did mention about ambition racing ahead of ability. I'm just giving a different, not color, but a different perspective where the similar thing happens. And that is where, you know, youngsters like all of you, you will complete your B-school education and tomorrow you will enter the corporate world. And you have read about a lot of things. You have read about organization development. You have read about change management, you have read about strategy, you have read about you know, a lot of other things which you are all raring to go and do it. And when you go to the organization, you don't see strategy, because you find that you are being asked to do some Excel sheets, you are being asked to make some customer calls, you are being asked to make some appointment letters, you are doing all routine things. So there, again, I am relating ambition means my aspiration. And you know what I am doing? I think there's a need for the person who's there in the organization, some of us who have spent a little more years, to temper the ambition, to bring people down to ground level and make them understand that work is not going to be all strategic, work is not going to be all developmental, work is not going to be all path breaking. Work is a good mix of the routine, the so-called mundane, and a creative part. And there, what my take will be that you need to make that routine also something that you enjoy. And how will you make it happen? If you focus on it, if you do it very systematically, if you keep your timelines, and if you realize that what Jeet said, that what routine I am doing is actually linked to a larger purpose, which is strategic. And at the root of all this, ladies and gentlemen, is that you have to be happy doing it. You need to enjoy doing it. In fact, we talked about Sachin Tendulkar, and apart from all the things that he had in terms of his stroke plays, knowledge about cricket, knowledge about where the ball pitches and turns, one thing that stood out was that he enjoyed playing cricket. Okay. And I'll just add one thing, I can't resist talking about it. So I read it somewhere, I think Chetan Bhagat wrote it, and he said, you know, in this room, I can say that most of us, you know, excepting some of us here, have an average of 50 years left. Each year has got 52 weeks. 50 into 52 is about 2,500 weeks. So ladies and gentlemen, you just have 2,500 weeks left. Your life is like a prepaid card with limited validity. So why fret and fume and get stressed? Just be happy and enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you for that. The point is not to take stress, right? Even if people are stressing the hell out of you. So, Professor Verma, right? One of the things, a lot of work is routine, right? I sign checks. It's not fun. But I got to sign it well, because if I don't sign it well, the check will bounce. Right? That's part of my job. Right? And there is a story we've all heard. I'm just sharing it for you. I mean, just to bring it back to point. You know, there was this man who was walking on the street, and there was this mason who was doing something, and he was asked, what are you doing? He said, I'm building the Taj Mahal, right? So, linking it back to purpose. If you know that you're building an edifice which is like a Taj Mahal, your job might be just lay bricks. But then you're connected with a larger purpose, and if you don't lay that brick properly, the Taj Mahal's foundation will be weak and will collapse, right? Now, coming back to your point, I mean, grading papers, that can't be fun. Right? How much do we say work awesome or inspiring excellence at work? I mean, a lot of work is also routine, and what needs to be done really well, because if the routine things don't happen well and mess up our lives, how do you manage that? And what are your thoughts and suggestions, and both of you, for young professionals in terms of how they can go about it?
Yeah. Let me just, you mentioned something earlier, I'll probably go back to my earlier days when I started teaching at XLRI, almost about 2.5 decades back, and it was an irresistible institution, there's no doubt about that, and I joined one of the top institutions to teach, where he was a student, you know, what I really liked that about that place was that the kind of leadership or the kind of principle-centered leadership which he spoke about, it was there as a part of the culture of that institution. And I guess that really made us feel pretty engaged with that organization. I really found it quite irresistible. First thing was, like, I was very young when I joined, and I was given absolute autonomy to design my course. You know, nobody told me at all that how should you teach and what's your lesson plan and what should you go about it. I was given absolute autonomy. And the people at the, you know, the deans and the directors had complete trust in me. The belief that whatever I do, I'll do with absolutely no issues at all. So I have the right kind of expertise to teach the students. And they were very transparent. They were very cooperative. So some of these things, which I believe were the principle of that, in, you know, that institution, even if you read that book of Principle Center and Leadership of Stephen Covey, which he mentioned about, and if you remember, I mean, if you know that there's, if you look at north, there's just one north. There's no other direction. So you might raise your hands and you'll probably point at all different sides. But there's only one side, there's the north. And that will never change. So it's like a compass. It will only point towards north. No matter what happens, they will never change. you know, maps can just change, but not the compass at all, the direction of that compass. So, there are certain principles which that institution has, and I guess every employee or every student should have, really work on those principles, and don't ever forget about them, you know. And those are the principles which I followed in my initial years, and that really helped me. And today also when I talk to my students, you know, the first thing which I tell them, look, you've joined a business school, you're going to be a professional, but that's not enough at all. One of those days when the corporate is going to be happy with this word called professionalism as such. They want you to be intrapreneurial. They want to go beyond that professionalism. They want you to take up responsibility and feel as if you own this organization. So you're not there working only from 9 to 5 or 9 to 6, that's it. No, you got to work for 24/7 for 365 days a year and believe as if this you own this organization. You have to take care of your balance sheet. You have to take care of profit loss statement. You got to take care of responsibilities. You know, we shouldn't really be after them at all. The companies, the bosses cannot be after you all the time as such. That's a kind of you know, discipline I try to set in my students, and I believe this is something which is really relevant and important for all of us to follow forever, because that's what will make you feel happy also. You know, it make you feel engaged in the organization, and that's the way probably we all try in this world as such. So that's what I felt about it.
Okay. So Professor Verma's talked about it, and I wanted to just link it back to the point that not all work is necessarily developmental, creative, stimulating. Necessarily, there's a lot of routine stuff that has to also done well. And I mean, if you're an entrepreneur, you talked about it, and I was thinking about it. You know, an entrepreneur doesn't, I mean, for him, we talk about work-life integration, right? As opposed to work-life balance. So when you think as a professional, it's not as if you start your work at 9 o'clock in the morning and end at 5 o'clock in the evening. I mean, we are maybe checking Facebook at work. We're taking personal phone calls at work as well. We're also answering emails maybe at 8 o'clock in the evening when we are at home. So in a sense, the world has become a bit more diffuse with technology entering. Because I can't leave really work back at office, and I can't really leave home back at home. And so how do young people, with so much of information proliferation, which is adding so much more stress to my life, right? How do I manage and navigate in this environment? And what do I do with all this routine work that has to be done well, especially when I start out in my career? Nobody's going to give me work to, say, formulate the next business strategy for the organization.
This is something which I was really contemplating and thinking, and I think that is really the big challenge. I heard Mr. Ramakrishnan, the first thing what he mentioned was how patiently he dealt with his manager, right? And he also spoke. So do you think that in today's youth we have that kind of patience? In today's workforce, do we have that kind of patience to deal with something like this? I'll have next day, I mean, some manager talks something like this with anybody, I mean, even with a 1 year experienced person, and next day I will have a complaint or, you know, whatever else to deal with it. I think times have changed. I think aspiration, I mean, how many of us here really indulge so much in, you know, activities which are very, very quiet, maybe fishing or just, you know, enjoying sitting by the seaside, or I don't know, all kind of those things have gone away from our lives. We don't even read a book peacefully, right? So it's a very, if you really look at it, I mean, if anybody has read Bertrand Russell, then he spoke about the virtues of boredom, right? I think there was a different world then probably, but it is so relevant. If I really see it, we all have to learn to deal with boredom. It is so important, and we don't, and that's really what I feel is the curse of today's time. So the minute, I mean, I see it to my, you know, with myself, you have 2 minutes and you want to see the, you know, phone and whether there is a message, whether there is a WhatsApp, there is, you know, something else. So we all are becoming impatient, and it is showing in our lives.
Reflective work, creative work, which is very distracted.
No. And that is where I think what is important is training. Because I think you need to, everybody needs to make a balance that life will not always, so while I do, I know in our own organization, we expect people to be entrepreneurs.
You know, that's
right?
What probably the Google does. If you look at read the HR policy of Google, it says that 20% of the time, every staff time, they just leave it to them. You do anything creative, absolutely not as for, you know, the regular routine job as such. You do whatever you want to do for the rest, those 20%. No distraction, no nothing to disturb you
at all. But 80% that they want
worker,
the work, right?
Yes, of course.
So, so that is where the challenge lies. Now, how do you, so it's a shift in people, the way they deal with it. And I think there's a lot of changes that we have to make adjustments or thinking of. Let's say, for instance, in HR, a lot of seniors, a lot of in the HR department itself, what I've seen is that their thinking has to change how they would deal with the youngsters of today, because it's a very different paradigm. I mean, you're dealing with people who are like a very different species than what we grew up. We had a lot of patience to deal with situations, which is not. So I think there has to be a balance that needs to be created. And I think while the companies, the corporates define and they want people to be, you know, more entrepreneurial, and that is really the need of the day. But I don't think that you can be entrepreneurial and do, you know, that kind of thinking and strategizing 100% of your time. So you need to create that balance. And the most important thing is what he mentioned earlier, that you need to, anybody and all of us have to get past the routine and the transactional work. There is no escape, right? Life is not going to be thrill every day of our life. So we need to learn to make balance, and there is no other way but to deal with the good that, you know, that comes with the mundane. I think that's what the learning is about.
So in closing, I'm going to give it back to Kevin for his thoughts. But I want to add a point. This whole entrepreneurship bit, you know, the whole question is, we think of entrepreneurship sometimes in revolutionary terms. You're going to change the world, right? A lot of progress is made through incrementality, right? And so I wanted to just link this whole thing about how do you create entrepreneurship in organizations. Can you really unleash that? And what would be your thoughts in terms of the two things that we talked about? One is this whole business of, you know, dealing with the routine and the mundane, and also wanting to be entrepreneurial at the same time. So what can I do?
Boy, that's a difficult thing. I remember reading a phrase that said, before enlightenment, chopping wood, carrying water. After enlightenment, chopping wood, carrying water. And life doesn't change too much from that. And I think the bulk of our time, it was interesting that you mentioned boredom. I had a coach and a teacher when I was young tell me, you've got to learn to be bored. And maybe your generation won't experience that, but ours did. And we've learned to really enjoy it now. So it's an interesting dynamic, isn't it? The idea to allow for the inspirational and entrepreneurial side of the spirit to emerge in a very controlled environment. Because most corporations, you're going to be in a cubicle in a very controlled environment with a limited box to play in. And we have the opportunity and the responsibility to start to create some kind of sense of freedom and some kind of sense of inspiration that will allow for the stretching and the growth and to push against that box until it gets disruptive, but we can try to be creative about it. And I think our generation is going to be learning a lot from this young generation about how to create that. You're going to have to help us see it because we didn't do it that well, but we're interested in seeing it. But I think your generation has the opportunity to change that. I think you have the way to find out how to work totally removed. I think your generation will move entirely away from the industrial age. We haven't all gone all the way there, have we? We're still stuck with some of that stuff, like time clocks and performance rituals that aren't necessary anymore, but we're still present. And I'm excited to see what you're going to do with that, because I truly believe yours will be the generation that will stop participating with the old industrial age ideas and free the world up. The danger will be whether or not you have the discipline to also succeed with that. And I think that if you will pay attention to some of us older folks about the discipline and that ability to handle the routine, and I thought this comment about control aspiration, get it into its right place at its right time, was a powerful observation, because it'll burn you up early if you can't get to what you think you should be getting to by the time you're 23 years old. You just have to know that's probably not going to happen, right? But keep that fire burning. But get excited about the idea that I think this group is going to figure out the answer to your question. I think I'll wait and see what they do to answer it after that.
Sure. Well, thank you. And thank you, panelists. And we'll open the floor for question and answer. So anybody, would you like to just get up, say your name, and probably just ask a question. You can direct it to any panelists or just leave it open.
Sure. So I'm Vivek, and actually just taking off from the very last point of discussion that was being talked about. So I'm personally, I do training with corporates in the area of leadership motivation. I also run a family business. Yeah. Now, very often when I talk about to people that this is the two things I do about, the instant reaction is, oh yeah, sure, so training is your passion and the business is something that you do to earn your living. 15, 20 years back, I would have probably agreed to it. Yeah, I would have said that. Today, I disagree. Yeah, and the reason I disagree is that having because I thought it was mundane. Today, I have come to a different conclusion because even when I do training, there's a lot of mundane work involved in it. Yeah, and I think the 20-80 ratio applies. In any job that you do, 20% is the maximum you can do creative. 80% is still about doing the mundane job. Even a painter has to, at some point, I believe, talk about, you know, when does he exhibit his paintings, how does he sell the paintings, how does he manage his finances, and it's 20% of the time he's actually doing the training. So again, as a message, maybe I belong to your generation and therefore to the younger people out here. I say that I've done a lot of creativity in a mundane business, and there's a lot of mundaneness in the most creative of businesses. Yeah? And I think it's all about how you do it. It really doesn't matter what you do. Yeah? So I just wanted to share that point. Yeah.
Any questions? Okay.